الرحمن إلا من أذن له الرحمن ورضي له قولا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. We begin with the praises that belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send His peace, mercy and blessings upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his beloved family members, upon his beloved companions, and upon all of us and our family members. Ameen, Allahumma ameen. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless me in my speech, to remove the defects of my tongue, to make my task easy for me, so that and bless it and grace it even more out of His grace and mercy, so that all of you can understand my speech. قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Isra, Surah number 17 and Ayah number 79, Allah says, O Prophet of Allah, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, stand up in some parts of the night and pray an extra salah. Pray an extra salah. So from this we understand, you and I have been given 5 salahs, but Allah's Rasul was commanded to pray an extra salah. And that is, Allah's Messenger says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, pray tahajjud as an extra salah. And because of this, it may be that your Lord will raise you to maqami mahmood. Brothers and sisters in Islam, it's always great to get help from a parent, from your parents, from your friends, from your family members, from your brothers, sisters, anyone. It's always great to get help when you are in difficulties, right? When you're in a state of distress and hardship, it's great to get help. But what if on a day that it becomes really, really severe and tough, and these same people can't help, who do you look to? You look to a person who's made dua for you. You look to a person who can help you. You look to a person whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, yes, this man will always be there for you. No matter what, no matter how thick, no matter how thin the problem gets, this man will stand up for you no matter what time it is. This man will be there for you. So inshallah, this man will be there for us inshallah. And Allah's Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has reported in a sahih hadith that Every prophet was given a dua. Every prophet was given a dua. And I have postponed my dua. I have postponed my dua so that I intercede for my ummah. So that I intercede for my ummah on the day of judgment. With that, inshallah, I introduce the topic of this night. Intercession on the day of judgment. This is not a very hard-hitting topic that you and I have to be really scared of. In fact, this is such a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that when you and I understand the concept of intercession, when you and I understand the concept of shifa' that Allah's Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will give, you and I will be so happy on that day that yes, no matter how many times you can, you know, literally fall down into sajda every single night only to tell thanks to Allah that you and I are in the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and not in any other prophet's ummah. It's a great blessing, wallahi I'm telling you, it's a great blessing to be in the ummah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's an honor. It's an honor that you and I are in the ummah. And above that, it's an honor that this beautiful man, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, will stand up on the day of judgment and will make dua for us, will intercede for us, will argue for us, will plead for us, will do everything it takes that you and I don't land up in Jahannam. For whatever sins you and I have committed in this earth, in our life, whatever it is, you and I might be the worst of sinners, but alhamdulillah, there is a man, there will always be a man who has supported the Muslims, who was for the Muslims, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةٌ لِلْعَالَمِينَ We have not sent, O Muhammad, we have not sent you except that you are mercy for the رَحْمَةٌ لِلْعَالَمِينَ for the mercy to the creation of Allah. And one of the greatest mercies that Allah's Messenger will show on the Day of Judgment is that he will plead, he will ask, he will request Allah for our Jannah to save us from Jahannam. Subhanallah. He knows he's going to get through. He's the man who will stand on the Day of Judgment and will say, my Ummah, and not Nafsi, Nafsi, myself, myself. He will be the person who will stand on the Sirat, on the edge of the Sirat, and say, Ya Allah, save them, not save me, save me. He is the man who will go into Jannah and will come back again. As we, inshallah, will talk in our class today, what Allah Rasul will do on the Day of Judgment. First, our topic is intercession on the Day of Judgment. The word intercession in Arabic is called shifa'. And what is the meaning of shifa'? What is the meaning of shafa'? Of intercession? It means, just by definition, it means asking someone to help either me or asking someone to help this person. That's intercession. I become a middleman, an agent between two people and say, let's rectify things between these two people. Let's rectify things. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's messengers will, the definition in Sharia is that intercession is defined as Allah's Rasul asking help, asking, pleading for us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let's understand what the Quran says about intercession. The greatest ayat in the Quran is Ayat al-Kursi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that beautiful ayat says, one part of that ayat says, مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ يَشْفَعُ يَشْفَعُ comes from the word شِفَاعَت. شِفَاعَت means intercession. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, who is there? Who will intercede? Who will intercede? Except, who will intercede? Except the one who is given permission. So the one to intercede is the one given permission. With that, let's ask ourselves a question, honest question. Who will have the authority? Who will have the permission to intercede on our behalf? Before we get that, let's understand what are the conditions for intercession. What is the condition that Allah has set for intercession? There are three conditions from the Quran and the Sunnah. Understand this. First, the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to be given. The permission of intercession has to be given to that man, to that person. One. Without Allah's will, nobody can intercede. One. Second, Allah has to be pleased with the intercessor. Allah has to be happy so that his intercession is allowed. First, a person should get permission from Allah. Second, a person should be, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be happy with the person doing the intercession. Third, the one who's being requested for, the intercession that is being done for, Allah has to be pleased with him. Whether in Jahannam or no, but still Allah has to be pleased with him at the time of shafa'at, at the time of intercession. So three things. One, the permission has to be given from Allah. Second, Allah has to be happy, be pleased with the person, with this intercessor. Third, Allah has to be happy for whom the intercession is done. So now let's come to who is entitled for this intercession. As I opened my talk with an ayat of the Quran in Surah Al-Isra, Surah number 17, ayah number 79. Allah says, O Muhammad, stand. Stand, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, stand in some parts of the night and pray tahajjud as an extra salah for you. For us, alhamdulillah, it's not made mandatory, right? Alhamdulillah. Fajr, we see five people, tahajjud, we would see only one man, right? So alhamdulillah, we don't have tahajjud as wajib. So, but for Allah's Rasul, Allah says, for you as an additional prayer, so that... Now Allah says, why an extra prayer for you? So that It may be that Allah may raise you to the Maqam-e Mahmood. Now let's understand what Maqam-e Mahmood is. Maqam-e Mahmood has two things. One, the highest station, the highest position in Jannah will be Rasulullah, no doubt. There's nobody else who will get a position of Maqam-e Mahmood in Jannah. The highest position, the most praiseworthy position. The second thing on the Day of Judgment, this same person, Maqam-e Mahmood, will be given the right of intercession. Will be given the right of intercession. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah's Rasul pray tahajjud so that you may be given the Maqam-e Mahmood, what do we understand from this? One, that he will be the highest position in Jannah, no doubt. There's nobody else. Second, that he will have the permission given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to intercede for us and nobody else. Yes, there will be other people interceding for us on our behalf. But that is only when Allah has admitted them into Jannah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that, O Prophet, an additional prayer for you so that you have the Maqam-e Mahmood. Now, let's understand a beautiful hadith before we get into some more details. Allah's Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, I am unique. I have been given 5 things that no Prophet has been given. Meaning he is unique, he is something different. So there was some additional gift that Allah gave only the Prophet alayhi salam. Why? Because he is the greatest of all Nabis. He is the greatest of all humans. He is the greatest of all creation. So what did he say? I have been given 5 things. One, number one, that never has been given before me. I was given support. I was given support in the battlefield through fear in the hearts of disbelievers. Allah gave fear in the hearts of disbelievers. Whether they were 300 men or they were 30 men, whether they were 30,000 people, they always had fear against Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That was one great gift that Allah gave. Second, Allah's Messenger says, the war booty, after the Muslims won, the war booty, that whatever they got, it was made halal for me and for my ummah. So this is the only nation that used to get booty from the war. And nobody else got this. Third, Allah's Messenger says, the whole earth is made a masjid for me. Subhanallah. The whole of the earth is made a masjid for me. Point number 4, he says that every prophet was sent for his people. Every prophet was sent for his people. But I was sent for mankind. For the alameen. I was sent for mankind, the whole of alameen, mankind. And fifth is, I have been given the right of intercession. Subhanallah. This is a mercy of Allah, a gift from Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah's Messenger has got a gift that no prophet got of right of intercession. From this we understand a small question. Can anybody else have the authority, have the permission in our life, when you and I say, brother, this person inshallah will help me on the Day of Judgment? Brothers, understand, when the likes of Ibrahim alayhi salam, when the likes of Isa, Musa, Nuh alayhi salam ajma'in, when Allah's Messenger says, nobody has got before me the right of intercession, how is it possible that anybody even could think that this man would save me on the Day of Judgment, that this person would be my savior on the Day of Judgment? Our entire focus, our entire belief itself is weak when you and I try to look for intercessors apart from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, inshallah, when people enter Jannah after the Prophet alaihissalam does the intercession, Allah will give every believer intercession. We'll do that. But there are certain people whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says there is no intercession for them. So who are they? Allah's Rasul says, Abu Darda radiallahu anhu narrates that those who curse others, they will not be witnesses nor intercessors on the Day of Judgment. So don't curse others. Always refrain from cursing, right? You come across a lot of people tending to curse anybody in left, right, center. right? Should remind them, brother, do you want to save people or you want to be in a position that people are going to save you? Right? Let us always try to be in a position that we can save people. That is the rahmah, right? Inshallah. Now, for example, we said the likes of Ibrahim alayhi salam, his own father Azhar, who committed shirk, right? He will be brought on the day of judgment. And Ibrahim alayhi salam will look at his father and say, I told you to obey me. His father will look at his son and say, today you saved me. Save me today. I know I didn't believe you, I didn't worship your God, I didn't obey you, but today you saved me. Ibrahim alayhi salam will look to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and says, Ya Allah, huwa abi, he is my father, Ya Allah. You have promised me that you will never disgrace me in this life and in the hereafter. You promised me, Ya Allah, that you will never disgrace me. Save my father today, Ya Allah. Whatever it is, save my father today. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, I have forbidden Jannah for the disbelievers. Subhanallah. Ibrahim alayhi salam for his father. This just puts a pause and says, if your father is on the wrong path, if your father is committing shirk, if your son is committing shirk, by Allah, before their death, correct them. I'm telling you, before their death, correct them. No matter what it takes, no matter what it takes, alhamdulillah, just go all out. Because when Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he was promised not to be disgraced, and he says to Allah, Ya Allah, you promised me, Ya Allah, that you are not going to disgrace me. And Allah says, I have forbidden Jannah for those who commit shirk. I have forbidden, khalas, it's haram. So today, there is no turning back. No matter what it takes, brothers, do your best to remove people from shirk. At least, whatever they do, forget it. But at least remove them from shirk. At least they have a chance. Wallahi, they have a chance. If they are indulging in shirk, there is absolutely no chance for them. So at least try, if you see shirk in your family members, peacefully, nicely, at least convey the message that what you're doing is wrong. By Allah, it is something, the worst thing that you will face on the day of judgment. So how do we get this intercession of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? How do you and I as Muslims get it? First, Allah's Rasul says, whoever reads Darood upon me will have the right of intercession. And the more you read, the more intercession you will have. Subhanallah. So the first thing from today is Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Anytime, everywhere, try to read as much as Darood, especially Fridays. It's a sunnah. To read as much as Darood as possible on Fridays, it's a great sunnah. Try to increase your Darood, inshaAllah, upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Second, Allah's Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the one who hears the call of the Adhan, alright, when you hear the call of the Adhan, and when the Mu'addan finishes his Adhan, then say, what? Allahumma rabba hazihi al-da'wati al-thamati wa salati al-qa'imati aati Muhammadin al-wasilata wal-fadhilata wab'athu maqaman mahmood. What do you pray? Oh Allah, give Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the wasila, the way, the fadila, the grace, wab'athu maqamam, and grant him the maqam mahmood. You yourself are asking the dua after every adhan. You yourself are asking Allah to make him the maqam mahmood, to give him the maqam mahmood. Then how do you and I even think that others will save us? Subhanallah. This dua after adhan is what? Allahumma rabba hadihi da'wati tamati wa salati al-qa'imati. Aati. Aati means give. Rabbana aatina. You say, oh Allah, give me. Fi dunya hasanatan. Give me this goodness of this life. So you say, aati Muhammadin il. Give Muhammad. What? Wal-fasila wal-fadila wab'athu maqama mahmood. Give Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You are asking in your dua. How do you think that anybody else can save you? Remove the concept, if you have, that your awliya, your peer, your this, your that, anybody can save you. Remove it. By Allah, apart from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, nobody can save you on the day of judgment. Allah and His Rasul. Allah's mercy and Allah's Rasul's shifa'at. May Allah give us them, inshallah, give us to them, to us. Yes. Now there are certain things, other things, that inshallah, when you and I do it in our life, those same things will come on the day of judgment and help us against and intercede for us. We are literally like our lawyers against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They will argue. The hadith is, they will argue with Allah subhanallah. Now what are these two things? There are two things that Allah mentions. One, subhanallah, what we are just doing, fasting. This entire month that we have done, Allah's Rasul says, whoever has fasted sincerely for the sake of Allah in the month of Ramadan, whoever has fasted one day sincerely for the sake of Allah, that same fasting will stand up. Allah will give him a mouthpiece. Allah will give him legs, will stand up, will go to Allah and argue for you. Ya Allah, listen what he is, what the fasting of yours, your fasting says to Allah. Ya Allah, I restricted him from food, from water when he was hungry and when he was thirsty. I restricted him from desires when he wanted to approach his wife. Ya Allah, I stopped him for your sake. He is sincere, Ya Allah. Forgive him today. Allah will say, I accept his intercession. Subhanallah. There is not a hadith that proves that your intercession, that fasting stands, will be rejected. The hadith, because Allah's Messenger has mentioned it, that fasting will stand on the day of judgment and argue for you, shows that Allah will accept the intercession. Second, great, subhanallah, great is the Quran. The Quran will come as an intercessor. So much so, brothers, inshallah, if you can do it from tonight, do it. Allah's Messenger says, Surah Al-Mulk before sleeping. Whoever reads Surah Al-Mulk before sleeping, Surah number 67, Surah Mulk will stand on the day of judgment and will argue behalf for you, on behalf of you, saying what? Ya Allah, he was sleepy, but I woke him up. He wanted to sleep, but I woke him up. Ya Allah, today I argue, I stand for him. So two things, the Quran, not just Surah Mulk, the Quran and fasting. Yes, the reward of Surah Mulk is remarkable for the one who reads it every night. The Quran and fasting. Next, what else can help you on the day of judgment as an intercession? Is Allah's Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, when a person dies, his janazah is laid, and if 40 people who have not committed shirk, 40 people of tawheed, 40 people who have not committed shirk, pray his salatul janazah and ask forgiveness, their shifaat, their intercession is accepted before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he will be forgiven. Subhanallah. So now make a list of people who you want to invite. Huh? Give a nice wedding card. Inshallah, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, this day I'm going to die. Inshallah, biryani will be served after my janazah, in this marriage hall. So inshallah, keep 40 cards ready. Huh? Choose people who you want to invite. And always make sure Al-Hajj is written before that. Right? Otherwise people don't come, man. No, I did Hajj for what? Right? You have to put my name, my tag before it, right? So, Allah's Messenger says, 40 people who have never committed shirk. So you might have 300 people in a janazah. But if 35 are left without shirk, still shafa'at is not done. You need, Allah's Messenger says 40. Arba'un. So now let's come to the intercession part on the day of judgment. Alright? Now we understood what's going to happen. Who's going to do the intercession? Let's come to the hadith that two nights back, I stopped at Nafsi Nafsi with Ibrahim, Musa, Isa, Nuh, and then I stopped at Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I told you, inshallah, in today's class, I will continue that hadith. Just quickly, let's go back to that hadith. What's going to happen? The day of judgment is going to start. The difficulties will start. The sun will be pulled as close as a mile. You and I will be drowning in our sweat. People then will go to the father of mankind, Adam. He will say, I have never seen Allah so angry. Today it's mine self, nafsi, nafsi. He will say, go to Ibrahim, Nuh. We all will go to Nuh. He will say, Nafsi, Nafsi, go to Ibrahim. We will go to Ibrahim. Ibrahim will say, I have lied. Today I am scared of Allah. Nafsi, Nafsi, myself, myself. Not anybody else. Go to Musa. Musa says, I killed a person. I don't know whether Allah will forgive me or no. Nafsi, Nafsi, myself, myself. Go to Isa alayhi salam. Isa will say, people worship me as a god. I don't know if Allah will forgive me or no. Nafsi, Nafsi, myself, myself. Go to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Everyone will go to Muhammad and they'll say, I have been given the permission to intercede. Subhanallah. And we will say, Ya Rasulullah, intercede, intercede. It's becoming hard, Ya Rasulullah. It's really tough on us, Ya Rasulullah. Intercede for us today. Allah's Rasul will go. This is the first intercession. Allah's Rasul has many intercessions on the Day of Judgment. This is the first. Remember, this is done even before the Sirat. This intercession that we are talking is done even before the Sirat. So you all understand where we're getting to, right? Sirat. Even before the Sirat. What type of intercession and for whom? Subhanallah. May Allah make us from them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's messenger says, I will go to Allah's throne and I will fall down in prostration. I will fall down in prostration. And I will be given words that I have never been given before. Allah will give me words. I will be given words that I have been never given before. And I will praise Allah with it in my sujood. And Allah will say, Ya Muhammad, raise your head. I will raise my head and look to the majesty, to the Jalal wal Ikram. I will look to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah will say, what do you want? Ask, it will be given. Intercede, and you'll have the intercession. Subhanallah. Allah's Rasul says, Ya Allah, my ummah, my ummah. Ya Allah, my ummah today. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O Muhammad, take all those people who have not been accounted from me, who have been skipped. Take all those people who have not been accounted from me and enter Jannah from the right side of the gate. Subhanallah. That means, this is the group brothers that Allah's Rasul will do the first intercession. Allah's Rasul will cross the Sirat with them and they will enter Jannah. They will be waiting near the gates of Jannah. They will enter it. You know what Allah's Rasul says? Subhanallah. Listen to this hadith. Phenomenal, phenomenal. Think of a gate. Alright? How big can you think of a gate? It's got two gates. How big can you think of it? Allah's Rasul says, that gate that these people will enter from one post to the other post is from Makkah to Basra. Subhanallah. From Makkah to Basra. Measure it. Subhanallah. This is the gate that these people will enter. Then Allah's Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, this is where everybody will now cross the Sirat. Everybody will cross the Sirat, and these people will be standing after crossing the Sirat, and Allah's Rasul will say, Ya Allah, save my ummah. Ya Allah, save my ummah. As I see people falling down, Allah's Rasul will be seeing people falling down of the Sirat. We did what the Sirat is yesterday. The people will be falling down from the Sirat, and Allah's Rasul will say, Ya Allah, these are my nation, my people, my believers. Save them, but they will fall down. Some, as I mentioned to you, some will come with hurts on the stomach. Some will come crawling. Some will come holding the Sirat and they will come in. And everybody will gather there. And then the second intercession is when people have fallen off the Sirat. May Allah save us from that. Ameen. And all the people have crossed it. Now there is no more Sirat. All the people have crossed it. And they are waiting for the gates to be opened from Jannah. The second intercession, again given to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Subhanallah. Allah's Rasul says in a Sahih Hadith that I will go to the gates of Jannah and say, open. And the gatekeepers will say, who are you? Who are you? And I will say, Ana Muhammad. And they will say, Subhanallah, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We have never been commanded to open the gate except for you. Subhanallah. We have never been commanded to open this gate except for you. The gate will open. Some ulama say, some rivayat say a camel from Jannah, some say a mount from Jannah. Whatever it is, it will come and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will sit on it and enter it. And lo and behold, will be the first group to enter. Will be the first group to enter Jannah. I'll give you a small hadith. Between, now understand, this is not you and me. You know who are the muhajir? Muhajirun? Who are the muhajirun? Anybody knows? The people who migrated with the Prophet. They are the best. Allah's Messenger says in a hadith, between the rich muhajir and the poor muhajir. The poor muhajir will enter first. Between the rich and the poor muhajir, there is 40 years. Subhanallah. Ya Allah, take away my wealth. Subhanallah. Meaning, this is how much Allah loves. When people were in poverty and they still strove hard for Allah's cause. Yeah, you have money, you can do anything. But the key is when you're poor and you still strive for Allah's cause. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. So that's the second intercession. The gates of Jannah being opened for us, for this ummah, and for all the others, whoever is there, and they will enter it. Then, the third intercession is for all those believers who fell down in the fire while crossing the Sirat. Allah's Rasul will come out and will run to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Will run to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Will fall down under His arsh. Will go back and fall down under the arsh. And will make a dua to Allah. Ya Allah, my ummah, save my ummah. Ya Allah, my ummah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will respond, O Muhammad, raise your head. What do you want? Says, Ya Allah, my ummah, my people are burning there. Subhanallah. This is one of the fascinating ayats of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Tawbah. Surah number 9, ayah number 128. لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا أَنِتُمْ حَرِيصٌ. There has come to you a messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who cries in his heart. Who cries in his heart when you face difficulty. Subhanallah. Allah says, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ. From amongst you a Rasul has come. Aziz, he's really close to the believers. And what is he to the believers? Ra'uful bir Rahim. Ra'uf. He's full of mercy for the believers. And he feels hurt that you and I feel difficulty. So he goes back and he cries, Ya Allah, my ummah, my people are burning down there, Ya Allah. I can't see it. Allah says, raise your head and go and take from Jahannam whoever has a grain, a barley grain of Iman, go and take them. Subhanallah. Allah's Rasul will go at the gate of Jannah and he will recognize people. He will recognize his ummah, whoever had a barley weight of Iman. And they will be pulled out. They will be pulled out. And just before the entrance of Jannah, there is a river called River of Life. Every person that comes out burnt in Jahannam will be asked to dip in that river and he will have life again. He will have the beauty of people of Jannah. And then inshallah, in my last talk inshallah on Thursday night, the last man that will come out and he will be dipped. He will be dipped in that water and he will come. And he will peep in Jannah and Jannah will be full. What happens to that man inshallah on Thursday night? Don't miss that. So Allah's Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Ya Allah, I have removed some people. Allah's Rasul will go back and bow down. Ya Allah, my ummah, Ya Allah, my ummah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Oh Muhammad, what do you want? He says, Ya Allah, my ummah, my people are burning down there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, go and find whoever has Iman less. The first one was equal to a grain, less than a grain of Iman. Go and pull them out. Subhanallah. Brothers, stop. I want you to understand what a barley grain is. Okay, forget a barley grain. Do you know what a rice grain is? How light and how heavy is a rice grain? Subhanallah. Allah is telling, go and pull people out who have Iman equal to that. Subhanallah. Can you just imagine, brothers, that you and I will be in such a state if you have to die in that state of that little Iman? What would our state even be on the Day of Judgment? When you and I are weighing on the balance a rice grain of Iman. Subhanallah. Just think on that mizan you're putting. Allah says, bring me your Iman. You won't bring a kg of rice. You bring one grain, man. And just imagine it falls off somebody. Allah, I lost it. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Stan. Right? One grain. Allah is telling, oh Muhammad, go and pull out people with one grain of Iman. Allah's Messenger will pull them out and they will enter Jannah. Then Allah's Messenger will go back and say, Ya Allah, my Ummah, my Ummah, my Ummah, my Ummah. Allah's Rasul, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, what do you want, O Muhammad? Say, Ya Allah, there are people dying there. There are people burning there in Jahannam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, go and pull people who have Iman less than an atom's weight. Less than an atom's weight. Dharra. Dharra in Arabic means less than an atom's weight. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Zalzala, فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَهُ. Everything of an atom's weight you do it, you will see it on the Day of Judgment. Every evil, every good you do, you will see it. Every evil you do of an atom's weight, ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ. Of evil, you shar is evil, khair is good. You do it, Allah will show it to you. So, this is what it means. Even if you're dharra, even if you have iman of dharra, you will be pulled out from Jahannam. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and Allah's Rasul will go back and say, Ya Allah, my ummah, my ummah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will says, khalas, over, over. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will go into Jannah. Allah's Messenger will go into Jannah. Astaghfirullah, not Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will go into Jannah. He's not over, brothers. He's not over. He will see people in the bottom of Jannah. He'll say, Ya Allah, that man loved me. Pull him to the Jannah al-Firdaus. Subhanallah. Allah's Messenger says, you will be with those whom you love. Allah says in a hadith, you will be with those whom you love. You love Umar, you will be with Umar. You love Abu Bakr, you will be with Abu Bakr. You love Rasulullah, you will be with Rasulullah. Says, Ya Allah, that man from my Ummah loved me a lot. He's in the second grade of Jannah. Pull him. Allah will say, your intercession is accepted. How many times Allah's Rasul is doing the intercession, brothers? How many times? Subhanallah. You and I will be in the lowest grade of Jannah. But because of his shafa'at, our economy class will turn into business class. And I love to narrate this hadith. I just love this hadith. Rabia bin Qab radiallahu anhu. Who is Rabia bin Qab? This man used to give water for wudu to Rasulullah. Alright? You and I can give water at Zuhar, Asr, Maghrib, Isha and Fajr. This man used to give water at Tahajjud time. Meaning, if Allah's Rasul would get up, this man was ready with water. Just think for this. If Allah's Rasul would get up at 1:30, 2 o'clock, 2 a.m., this man was already up with water waiting for Allah's Rasul to get up. Subhanallah. This is Iman. And he is one of the lowest Sahabas, huh, by the way. Subhanallah. Rabia bin Qab radiallahu anhu. Once, one fine day, Allah's Rasul is making wudu. And this man is pouring. He says, Ya Rabia, you do this every time for me. Tell me, what do you want? You want dirhams, you want dinars, you want to get married to a girl? Subhanallah, right? We'll do all this to get married to a nice girl. Says, Ya Rasulullah, Allah says, you want to get married to a girl? You like somebody? You want horses? You want camels? What do you want? He says, Ya Allah, Ya Rasulullah, will you give me what you promised for? Says, I want to give you something. Tell me. He says, Ya Rasulullah, I want to be with you in Jannah. Subhanallah. Look at this man. He is serving water. He's asked for something and he says, Ya Rasulullah, I want to be with you in Jannah. Meaning my Maqam-e-Mahmood is booked. Right? My place next to the Maqam-e-Mahmood is booked. Subhanallah. This is what the Sahabas were. Nothing, brothers. No wealth. Nothing. For them, it was Rasulullah. That's it. That itself makes a class apart. You and I have the love for Rasulullah, but when it really comes, do we really choose Rasulullah over money? Doubt. Those people were like, just made of a different steel. Trust me, they were made of a different metal. That metal, the stock got over and we are all scrap material now. All seconds. They were made from a different material. Subhanallah. And that's why Allah chose them to be the Sahabas. Remember in my Sunday class, I told you a hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. Allah saw the hearts, and He saw the best of hearts in the entire human being, entire humankind. And the best of heart was Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So He chose him to be the Rasul. Then He looked in the other hearts, and He found the best to be the Sahaba's hearts. So He chose the Sahaba's to support the Rasul in his cause. Subhanallah. Meaning the best of hearts that ever lived were the Sahaba's. You and I have 1,400 years hearts. The gap between their hearts. Right? Subhanallah. So what happens? The first, another intercession, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, that raise your rank. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, call whom you love. Allah also says, this man loved me, this man followed me, he's in the lowest grade of Jannah. Yes, Jannah, you're enjoying. There's absolutely no complaint. Yet, but Allah's Messenger says, this man loved me, he followed me, pull him up. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give permission for others to intercede. Subhanallah. Lo and behold, you and I in Jannah, inshaAllah, we'll have a choice that Allah will give to intercede. But when? After so much of, after such a long time, but still alhamdulillah. So, we will go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whoever is in Jannah and whoever has a chance that Allah gives to intercede, we will come to Jannah, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and says, Ya Allah, Ya Kareem, my brother is missing in Jannah. My father is missing in Jannah. We prayed together, Ya Allah. We fasted together, Ya Allah. My wife, Ya Allah. My children, Ya Allah. We fasted together, Ya Allah. We prayed together, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, they are down there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, go and pull your family members. Go and pull whoever you want. We will go and stand on the brink of Jahannam, and subhanallah, the fire will not burn the marks of our prostration. The fire will not burn the marks of our prostration. And you and I will be recognized by those marks. The fire will burn everything except the marks of our prostration. And we will be recognized by those marks. And they'll say, Ya Allah, he's my brother, he's my cousin, he's my uncle, he's my aunt, he's my wife, everything. Whatever, Allah will say, pull them out. Just imagine that guy coming out and say, Jazakallah, brother, Subhanallah. Man, you've done, whatever favors you did in your life, man, forget all those favors. That favor of life, you pulling me out of Jannah, of Jahannam, was the greatest that you can do. That's why I always say, try to be the one that you can help, inshallah. Don't be the ones that you're looking for help. Do deeds that Allah will be pleased and say, go and remove somebody from Jannah, from Jahannam. Can you and I be that person? For at least somebody of our family members. Somebody. If you and I can be that person, do such one deed that Allah loves and says, oh Muhammad, go, or this or that, go and remove that person. Just imagine the joy and that family member's face, subhanallah. The whole life is one side, that happiness on that family member's face is another side. Then, the people of Jannah will intercede for the people of Jannah. How is that? The people of Jannah will intercede for the people of Jannah. Your mother was really, really pious. She was a muttaqi lady. Prayed, fasted, did everything. She's in the fifth Jannah. You, rascal. Total rascal. Somewhere lying down there. She says, Ya Allah, he's my son, Ya Allah. She says, Zindagi mein chodi, Jannat mein chodi. Whatever it is, a mother is a mother. A father is a father. Yes, on the day of Muqantara, you'll turn around. But when you are in Jannah, that love will come back. Ya Allah, he's my son, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, he's my father, Ya Allah. So if your father is in a higher Jannah, and your son is in lower Jannah, your mother is in a higher Jannah, your wife is in lower Jannah, yes, this is the time. Wife, I'm going to get you up, man. All my life, you had my remote. Today, I have your remote. Subhanallah. Up, down, which one? Right? Subhanallah. So, the people of Jannah will intercede for the people of Jannah. If they are in lower Jannah, subhanAllah, lo and behold, Allah will say, you love them, you want to be with them, your family, pull them out. Your friends, pull them up. And the best part is you don't degrade, you upgrade. Right? You don't come down to a first class to an economy class, right? You go from an economy to a first class. Then a shaheed will come, a martyr will come and say, Ya Allah, Allah will say, bring all the martyrs of Jannah, from Jannah, bring all of them. And they will say, Allah will say, you have 70 people that you can pull from Jahannam. Subhanallah. 70 people a martyr will get from Jahannam. He'll be pulled. Get the people who studied the Quran. The people who study the Quran will come. Pull them out. Choose, pull anybody out. They will pull them out. So much so, it says, Allah's Rasul says, that if, subhanAllah, ladies, I'm jealous of you, alright? When you have a fetus that dies, even before birth, alright? That same child will be given life on the day of judgment. And he will be made to sit with whom? Do you know? The children who die under the age of puberty, they will be with Ibrahim alayhi salam in Jannah. Subhanallah. They will be with Ibrahim alayhi salam in Jannah. The same child that died in your stomach will be given Jannah. And with the if his mother is not in Jannah, with his umbilical cord, she will be dragged into Jannah. Subhanallah. But the condition was, if you only had patience. Allah's Messenger says, by the one in whose hand my soul is, the miscarried fetus will drag his mother by his umbilical cord in Jannah, if she sought the reward by patience. So if she was patient, yes. If the child had died and she had cursed or complained to Allah, then Allahu alam, brothers, I'm not in a position to say the reward. Next, Allah's Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the parents who lost their children under the age of puberty, who were young and they lost their children, the children will be made to enter Jannah. The children will be made to enter Jannah, but the children will refuse. They will stand at the gate of Jannah and say, Ya Allah, we won't enter without our parents. We will not enter, Ya Allah, without our parents. Allah will say, go look for your parents and bring them in. Subhanallah. Our children, brothers and sisters, will be the cause to dragging us into Jannah from Jahannam. With that, I end my talk with a beautiful hadith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the prophets will intercede. Their intercession will get over. The angels will intercede. Their intercession will get over. The people of Jannah will intercede. Their intercession will get over. Then the Almighty, the Rabbul Jalali wal Ikram, the Aziz, the Ghafoor, the Mannan, will pull out people from Jahannam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will pull out. Allah says that the Almighty will say, now remains my intercession. And he will pull out from people of Jannah, from Jahannam, and all their bodies will be burnt, and they will be thrown in the river of life, and then made to enter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, lo and behold, brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, but as for those who disbelieved and committed shirk, there will be no intercession from my side. Allahu Akbar. Meaning, that is the time when Jahannam will close. That is the time when Jahannam will close. And there will be no more intercession left. Allahu Akbar. May Allah save us from that. Brothers, I just want you to think, no matter what the situation is, fine, you and I might be pulled out of Jahannam, but just for a minute, can you think of this world's fire touching you for 1 month, for 1 day, What's going to happen to your skins, to your bodies, to your faces, to your hearts, to your stomachs, to every single part of your body? What is going to happen to all those parts for one whole day if you are in the world's fire? Subhanallah, think about it. The fire of Jahannam is not the fire of this world. Inshallah, tomorrow we will deal with the fire of Jahannam and what the Jahannam is. And may Allah save us from that. With that, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.